In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome. Welcome here physically. Welcome here virtually. The second Sunday in Epiphany. I'm picking up a conversation earlier. Lent will come sooner than you expect. Very strange year. So let's celebrate the present. Worship our Lord. Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The grace of God has dawned upon the world through our Saviour Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself for us to purify a people as his own. Let us confess our sins.
Almighty God,
our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Amen.
all the poverty of our nature by the riches of your grace, and in the renewal of our lives make known your heavenly glory. Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, for God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. The boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At the time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel," and he said, "Here I am." And ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I do not call, lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I do not call, my son, lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, reading from the book of Revelation. I saw in the right hand of the one seated on the throne a scroll written on the inside and on the back sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?" And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or look into it. And I began to weep bitterly, because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered, so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals." Then I saw, between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, a lamb standing as if it had been slaughtered, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He went and took the scroll from the right hand of the one who was seated on the throne. When he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. They sing a new song: "You are worthy to take the scroll and open its seals, for you were slaughtered, and by your blood you ransomed for God saints from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them a kingdom and priests serving our God, and they will reign on earth." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the Gospel of the Lord.
I wonder if you have managed to get to a pantomime this year. A favourite occasion, certainly, for many Christmases. Particularly if you have children, grandchildren, tends to be what you do. And there's a wonderful opportunity, of course, to join in the warm glow of theatre land. And to be with those crowds shouting, "He's behind you." Oh no, he isn't. Oh yes, he is. And so on. You'll be pleased to know that I'm not going to encourage you to join in that way as I go through this sermon this morning. Although if you're inclined to do so, then so be it. But at first glance, of course, two of our readings today have the same element of panto about them. Just look at the Gospel reading and look at that Old Testament reading where there are misunderstandings on show between the participants, and that, of course, is what is normally the focus of pantomime, where people misunderstand what's going on. But happily, there is a happy ending to them when there is a greater revelation of God's presence than previously they've understood. And those readings share the story of how three people, Samuel, Philip, and Nathaniel, respond to the call of God. But what does it mean to be called by God? It's something the church uses a lot of. How does God make his gift of salvation known to us, his people? How do we know when it is God who is actually calling and speaking to us? And how do we respond to that call when we discern it is? Some of our fellow Christians, of course, speak almost of an exact moment, in their words, when they become Christians. In the case of the boy Samuel, God was speaking to him directly, but it needed Eli to explain that to him. And I would suggest we too often need other people, perhaps the church, to discern the voice of God. And in the course, in the call of Philip, it seems to me that again there was this immediate recognition of this special nature of Jesus. So much so that he then goes and rushes to Nathaniel, who took a little bit more encouraging. "Come and see, come and see," says Philip. And then when Nathaniel encounters Jesus, it's at that instant, like a log being split by an axe, that the secret is revealed and the presence of Jesus is known to him. And so we might want to categorize both Philip and Nathaniel as being in that "when I became a Christian" camp. But the reality for many of us is that we are not in that camp. And we certainly shouldn't ever feel inadequate if you can't point to the day or the date when you became a Christian, as some who can and do that try to make you feel. I always mention my baptism date if anybody says to me, "When did you become a Christian?" And if we are like that, and it's not that instant date, then we are in good company, as I'll share with you a bit later. But for some of us, our journey of faith, of course, has been there almost from as long as we can remember. From the start of our lives, perhaps. And for others, it will have been a gradual development with stops and starts on the way. I certainly have some of those in my journey of faith too. and it was for another man too. Born in the early 1920s, brought up just north of Liverpool. His father wasn't a believer, but his mother sent her children to the local Methodist Sunday school. And a school friend suggested that he join them for local confirmation classes at the local evangelical church. A clear come and see moment, if ever there was. Well, he tagged along, but he admitted much later that it was largely because the group included a very pretty girl that he was sweet upon. And like others in that group, he didn't take those classes very seriously. The confirmation service was held, but not in that church, but actually down the road at an Anglo-Catholic church called St. Faith's. And it made a huge impression on him. And then, encouraged by his elder sister, he later took his first communion at that St. Faith's church without his parents being present there. And at his funeral, many years later, the preacher recalled that the colour, order, beauty of the Catholic tradition of the Church of England captured his soul as a young man. And he received his religion through the eyes quite as much as through the ears. And his was a faith that was touched by all the senses. And I was only speaking last week after our service here, saying much the same thing about our worship when we were chatting about the use of incense, chatting about the use of vestments and colour and sound. We worship God not only with our mouths and with our words, but with all of who we are. But to go back to this man's story, well, he served in the war, had a military cross, then he went off to Oxford University, ended up with a first class degree, and then it was, what am I going to do now? Well, after he had a conversation with his brother-in-law, who had trained as a priest at Westcott House, he said, well, I'll go along there too then. It was the easiest thing to do, and he said, I can always get out of it if it's not what I fancy doing. Now, many of you might already have recognised him as Robert Runcie, of course, who went on to serve as the Archbishop of Canterbury from 1980 to 1991. And about whom Graham James, the Bishop of Norwich, preached at his funeral, said this. Robert wanted people to be drawn in their humanity to the God in whose image they were made. And he always saw God in them, as well as the flaws and failures that make human beings seem so frequently ridiculous. That was why he was so patient with a fallen world and a defective church. And I think that understanding gives me great confidence that no matter what might be going on in the church and in the world, I believe that God's purposes will work through in the end. And Runcie also urged church leaders not to take themselves too seriously too. And he said a sense of the sacred without a sense of humour becomes legend. A mantra I would urge you all to continue to try to follow here in the months and the years ahead in this Minster church. A sense of the sacred without a sense of humour becomes legend. Beware. And so you see, we don't all have to have had that revelation moment of when I became a Christian. God can and does always work with who we are. And it is who we are that God calls us in his service to his people. So what are we to take from that response to the call of God by those three, Samuel, Philip and Nathaniel, and by Robert Runcie too? And how can we keep at the forefront of our mind that God calls us to? That God, in our baptism, gives us the power to become his children. And with this knowledge, how can that shape our lives for the next week and beyond? Well, we are in this Epiphany season, be it not for too long, and we know that the season began with the journey of the Magi. And it's a season that is a good time, I think, to look back and reflect upon your own journey of faith. It may also be a time for you to pray and to give thanks to God for those people who have had a come and see or pointed the way moment in your journey of faith too. It could be your parents, could be your grandparents, could be a friend, could be a stranger, but somebody who perhaps has encouraged you on your journey of faith. And then perhaps to contemplate in prayer these two questions for yourself. How is my faith in 2024, with this call of Jesus to me, going to make a real difference in your life? What does it matter to you in this coming year? And then finally, how is my faith going to make a difference to my neighbours' lives too? Whoever and wherever they may be. And your answer is going to be different to those sitting next to you. But reflect upon it, pray upon it, recognize God calls you. We just need to hear and not say, oh no, he doesn't. Amen.
Let us declare our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, the Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
Almighty God, as the first disciples came to faith in Christ, so may the Church be faithful in following him. We pray for our Archbishops Justin and Stephen, for our Diocesan Bishop Pete as he takes his sabbatical, and the Bishop Sophie as she takes on more responsibility over the next few months. We pray for our Archdeacons Jared and Malcolm, and all who work in the Sheffield Diocese. We pray for all who lead our services and all who come to worship you in our church. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, where there is hostility between nations and races, bring the peace of Christ. We pray for the people of Israel and Palestine amid the frightening violence. We pray for those killed and injured and those who grieve. We bring before you the civilians of Gaza and ask for protection for those taken hostage by Hamas. We continue to pray for the people of Ukraine, that the war there will soon come to an end. And we pray for the area around the Red Sea, where there is escalating violence. We pray for the wounded and the captive, the grieving and the homeless, that they all may know your love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, help us all to guide in the right way those who are near to us. We pray for our city and all who live or work here. We bring before you our civic and elected mayors and all members of the council. We pray for all who are struggling to pay for food and heating in this cold weather. We pray for the food banks and give thanks for the volunteers and all who donate to them. Let the homes of this community be blessed with the presence of the Lord. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Gracious Lord, have mercy on all who are imprisoned in old feuds and rivalries, who have ceased to believe in the power of good. Grant that they may lose their fear and see love in the eyes of the stranger. We bring before you today all those known to us who are sick or in need. Be near to them in their hour of need. Let the light of hope shine through their darkness and give them comfort in their afflictions. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Eternal Father, we give thanks for the departed to whom heaven has been opened and the divine vision granted. We pray for Nick Cowan, who died recently, and for Rosalind Dorothy Jackson, Bill Ware, Harold DeVille, Iris Poulston, Clifford Spencer, and Lucy May Beale, whose anniversary is for this time. May our faith in this world bring us to follow Christ until we come to eternal life. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray in the name of Christ, the Son of God. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Saviour Christ is the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there shall be no end. Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
To give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise for your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit he took flesh. As your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. And we give you thanks, because in the incarnation of the Word, a new light has dawned upon the world, that all the nations may be brought out of darkness to see the radiance of your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing. same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. Gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. And this, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."
Mystery of faith.
Rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. We offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. George and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
With confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Presume to
Come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen.
with your word, who is the bread of life. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, that through us the light of your glory may shine in all the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Mighty God,
we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
You will see from the weekly sheet that next Sunday is a little different. There will be any 30 Book of Common Prayer Holy Communion, and that's because at 11 o'clock we shall be holding the civic service here for Doncaster. So I hope you come to either of those, certainly. And then at 4:30 there will be a choral evening song too. So plenty for you to engage with if you're able to do so next week. Can I also thank those who had a word with us after the service last week about being stewards? Thank you, we had a response from that. But we do need more people. So if you're still thinking about it, which I'm sure that's the right thing to do, and you've come to a decision and said, yes, I'd like to be a steward or at least explore, then again have a word with me after this service or one of the church wardens indeed. And then just come and try. Come and see, in the words as we heard. Come and see what it's like to be a steward. And you never know, it may be something that you're able to do. And again, as I say, there isn't a long-term commitment to this. You're not here every day. It's not an expectation of that. It is something that certainly those who do it greatly enjoy it. And it is good that we have the opportunity to welcome people into this church. So it might be you that God is calling to be a steward, as they say. Again, my last service is drawing that bit nearer. There is a note about that here. If you haven't signed to say you're going to be staying, then do so if you can, so it can help with sort of the preparations. We are mindful that you don't have to be bringing something to come and eat something. So don't feel if you haven't signed up and say, well, I can't make a cake or buy a cake or whatever. Just come to it and stay. It doesn't mean if you sign up you have to actually be bringing something with it. That's not the point of it. Just come. But it's helpful to know if you're going to be staying, and you're more than welcome to do so if you're able to do that. So it is a joy to have our choir after their Christmas break. So welcome back, one and all, to you indeed. They do enhance our worship so much.
We'll therefore sing our final hymn.
Thank you.
perfect in you the image of his glory, gladden your hearts with the good news of his kingdom. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.